Get off the stage and go ahead and bring up Jennifer McNeely.
With the intro music, it's like, did I say something? Did I just stand here? I think I did a pretty good job, you know. So, like Chris said, my name is Jennifer. Any variation of that is just fine. Jen, Jenny, J-Dog. Nobody ever picks J-Dog, it's all right. If they did, I'd have to find a new opening joke. So I come from the Lubbock area. The reason I say Lubbock area is because that's the closest landmark that isn't a cow or a meth lab. Yeah, I'm country, y'all. Grew up outside of a small town called Smyre. Anyone heard of it? Of course you haven't. It has about 500 people. Holy shit, you've heard of it? Wow, you escaped? Whenever I was growing up, I would go to other small towns and envy their amenities. Just, man, y'all got a blinking light? That is classy as hell. I go up there about once a month to visit my parents. They still live at the old homestead. They are getting up there in years. They're actually getting old enough to where when I walk in the house, there's even odds that they're not going to have clothes on. Not because of dementia or anything, but you'll know all those shits that you have to give in your daily life. They're out. Yeah. I'm pretty sure my family has a genetic defect where our give a shitter breaks really early on in life. If family history is any indication, I've got about 10 years left. I'm 38 years old. You are right to know. No, there is nothing cool about being 38. No, ma'am. I know you're 38 as well, so you know this. I've been able to drink for a while, smoke for a while. Hell, I can even rent a car and take it across state lines. All of those milestones are gone. I mean, the only milestone left is the big 4-0. And I thought about having a big 40th birthday party. I did. But then I got to thinking, those are kind of like quinceañeras for drunk bitches. Yeah, because, I mean, I've been to those before. And it is. The birthday girl is always just three sheets to the wind, talking about, woo, 40's the new 20. Oh, so we get to count in dog years. That's cool. Shit starts to go really wrong after you hit 35. The other day I woke up and my eyebrow hurt. My eyebrow! The best I can figure is I was practicing my come hither looks extra hard. Just that's supposed to be seductive. The best I can do. Starting to get a lot of gray hairs. Fortunately, they are all on top of my head. When they start moving south, I think I'm just going to close up shop. Sorry, guys. Vagina's closed. Terrible. I'm not good enough to keep a fire in the oven when I got snow on the roof. Sorry about you. So I feel like as a female comedian, you are expected to talk about vaginas, so let's get that out of the way. Vaginas are weird. There, I said it. Looked at mine once, scared me. Looked like a Yeti with a bad comb over. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why I call it my vagina. Nothing else fits. It's not a cute little cunny. It's not a playful little pussy. It's not even a hard-banging cunt. I've got a refined southern gentleman living in between my legs who has to be introduced formally. This is my vagina. Of the Atlanta vaginas. He'll be joining us for this evening's entertainment. Guys love it when you do that. Especially the hip wabble part. So it should surprise no one to find out that I am married. Been married, I know, it's disappointing. But I've been married for 8 years. 11 if you count my first husband. Not sure why people don't do that. Hell, I want credit for time served.
Hell yeah!
Yeah. That usually gets some good applause. Lots of bitterness in this audience. Y'all are my kind of people. I call my first husband my practice husband. Because emotionally unavailable asshole doesn't roll off the tongue quite as well. Relationship was doomed to begin with. His mama could not cook.
That's mama.
I'm a big girl, y'all. I have expectations in the culinary department, and she was not meeting them. Woman could not make mashed potatoes. How in the hell do you live in Texas and not know how to make mashed potatoes? Right. It's potatoes and butter and salt and milk, and you mash it all up, and there's the love. My mama. She puts at least a stick of butter in every batch of mashed potatoes she makes. Could be one potato, at least a stick of butter. And I love that woman more every time she does it. My mom's one of those old southern cooks. She is amazing. She has flat out ruined me for some foods for life, like banana pudding. I cannot eat banana pudding unless it's hers because, okay, if your recipe for banana pudding starts with grab a box of instant, get the fuck out of my kitchen. Yeah. That shit's gotta be made from scratch. And you gotta stir the shit out of it. And if you develop a blister, you know you're getting close. The bigger the blister, the better the pudding. My mama threw out her wrist one time making a banana pudding. Best damn banana pudding I ever tried. She was hardcore with that shit. Growing up, she didn't even bother with the toaster. She'd grab a slice of bread, butter it up, and then slam it down on the grill, keep her hand there, and maintain an eye contact. I didn't act up a lot as a kid. She was scary. So yeah, I got that to live up to. I do have to say, I'm a pretty fair cook. But you know, my husband would not care even if I was the worst cook in the world. No, it's not because he loves me or some shit like that. It's because he has the palate of a second grader. As long as I keep those Pop-Tarts and chicken nuggets coming, he's a happy man. He's a picky eater. I don't understand that. I love food, obviously. I do. Sweet, sour, savory, salty. I will destroy that shit. Except for celery. Fuck celery. Yeah. And fuck anyone who tries to turn it into a fun snack. You know the people I'm talking about. Ma'am, I just don't know what to say to that. Yeah, you're probably the person that comes in with the celery on a platter trying to hide it in some peanut butter and raisins. And then you take a piece and eat it like it's good and you're like, oh, isn't this a fun snack? No, ma'am, celery is not fun. Celery is lettuce that gave waterway and got sand. That's why it tastes like chlorophyll and regret. If you come at me with celery, it better be shoved in a turkey's ass. That's the only situation in which it is acceptable.
I'm okay with that.
Now, celery is pretty interesting, though. It goes through all three phases of matter in the fridge. I don't know if you know this or not, but what happens when you have celery? It's usually, for me at least, not you weird celery lovers over here. When I have celery, it's because I have it for a recipe, and that then what do? You shove the rest into the back of the refrigerator. Now, at first, it's a solid. If you wait a couple of weeks, it turns into a liquid. Kind of gross. But if you wait a really, really long time, all of the celery evaporates and the little celery molecules are floating around in your refrigerator. And then when you open it up and release the celery out into the world, that's where sadness comes from. So I've been trying to eat healthier lately. That's a great follow-up to that story. I have, though. I've been trying to eat healthier. Problem is, I don't know that I'm wired to turn down food. I mean, I've seen people do it. I have. I have a friend who, she's on a diet. She's doing wonderful. The other day we were at a party. They had a great spread. Chips, queso, dip, cookies, those little sandwiches. Oh, I love those. And I was filling up my plate. And I turned around to her and I was like, hey, you want in on this? And she's like, no, thank you. I'm on a diet. Oh, that's great. How the fuck do you do that? Are you a fucking wizard? I cannot turn down food. And it's hard shopping for healthy food because there are so many labels nowadays. Okay, so let me ask, are any of y'all on a gluten-free diet? Oh, I... Oh, they are. Okay. Now, I don't understand that because we have Southern cooking here, and the gluten is where you keep the love.
Okay.
So, I mean, how do you live life like that? I mean, I'm about 80% gluten at this point. They go crazy with that shit, too. The other day, I saw gluten-free shampoo. Pretty sure my hair does not have celiac disease. There's also non-GMO, another thing I do not understand. Y'all know what GMOs are, right? Genetically modified organisms. Thank you for playing. Yeah, genetically modified organisms. You know what else was genetically modified organisms? Motherfucking X-Men. That's right. Every good superhero story starts with genetic modification. You either are genetically modified, you eat something, you get bitten by it, splashed on, you know, whatever. I mean, think about it. You could be eating your morning cereal and it has GMO corn. And you eat it and boom, you have the powers of corn. Okay, that's a bad example, but you get my point. Now, these labels, they are not just in the grocery section. Cosmetics, too, have a lot of labels. Now, one that I can get behind is cruelty-free. If your job description in any way involves making chimpanzees and bunnies look slutty, please find another job. For the literal meaning, though, I do think that every girl needs a little bit of brutal honesty when putting their makeup on in the morning. I think a little bit of cruelty in their makeup would be a good thing. I mean, think about it. You're putting on your lipstick and it pipes up. You think you got enough eyeliner on? Poor. Man, dog food, they have gone crazy with that shit. Oh, your dog needs all-natural, raw, vegan, organic dog food. That's great. He's eating his shit right now. What about that, Cheryl? And you know, I mean, I think that I have three dogs myself, and I look for labels as well. It's just different kinds of labels, like contains actual meat, fit for consumption. Now with 50% less rectal bleeding. You know, stuff like that. Truth be told, I'm going to get real with y'all for a minute. If there was a pickup on the side of the road selling dog food by the scoop out of the back, I'd totally buy it if they just slapped an all-natural sticker on it and the price was right. Because at that point, I'm just looking for plausible deniability. It's just like, I don't know what happened. It said all-natural. Did everything I could. So I don't have kids. Usually that question follows up that joke, so I'm just going to cut that off in the past. Yeah, don't have kids. It's not the fact that my husband and I don't like kids. It's the fact that my uterus does it. And at this point, I'm kind of like, good job, uterus.
Yeah.
I like being able to go and do what I want when I want. I like to be able to sleep without worrying about some creepy-ass kid waking me up at 3 a.m. wanting some water. And kids, I tell you, they have messed with my worldview. Because before my friends started having kids, I used to think that humans were good by nature. But kids have made me realize that the only reason we are not complete bastards is because there are laws. Because children are what we would be if we had completely free will, which is apparently touching your genitals in public and saying rude things to strangers. You're fat. Well, you're creepy. There's a reason that toddlers are not allowed near sharp things. It's not for the toddler's benefit. It's because, you know, tiny psychopaths. So I've been rocking this short haircut for a while. Gotta say, I am a fan. It's easy to take care of. It looks good. It feels good. And it turns out, one of my biggest fears did not come true. People do not mistake me for a man any more than they did in the first place. Yeah, that has happened all my adult life. At least twice a week, I get called sir. And I do get it, I do. I mean, if I'm up on stage, if I'm dolled up, I look good, obviously. But if I'm not, I mean, I roll out of bed, whatever my hair looks like, it looks like. And, you know, I put on, like, flannel and jeans, ready. Other day I was in HEB like that, and it was an online, and I was playing on my phone, and a manager comes up to me behind me, and she's like, excuse me, sir, and I turn around, I'm used to it, she is mortified, and she's like, oh ma'am, I'm so sorry, ma'am, if you would like, you can go to the express lane, and I'm like, well, I'm wearing, I have more than 15 items here, and she's like, ma'am, it's fine, just tell me I sent you. I smelled an opportunity. So I went home, got extra manly, and I went out to exercise my newfound male privilege. Yes, I did. It was amazing. It was like my opinion suddenly mattered.
Get up now.
Oh, yeah, get out of the kitchen, too. It's awesome. I went into my job, and my boss was like, you know what? I don't know what's different about you, but I like it. Have you ever thought about management? I peed standing up. I did not hit the toilet. But neither do you guys half the time, so that worked out all right. Ultimately, I did decide to go back to my womanly ways because, for one, I like to be able to talk about my emotions without people making fun of me. And tits are just awesome. Who's with me on that? Tits are amazing. These things are better than fidget spinners. Yeah. Ladies, when you get home, if you don't take your bra off and immediately start playing with the girls, what the hell are you doing with your life? And I mean, I'm not talking about playing like, I'm talking about, like, I dance with mine. I mean, just like, okay, I'm not going to grope myself on stage, but I'll pantomime the hell out of it. Just da da da. And then sometimes I like to act like my boobs are the main characters in a soap opera, just like, oh John, I love you, but I am married. Oh Marcia, I love you too. Kiss me.